Hello, everyone. My name is Andrea Webster. I work for IU's Environmental Resilience Institute as part of the Prepared for Environmental Change Grand Challenge. This is the Prepared for Environmental Change webinar series, and we're happy to have you with us here today. Before we get started, I want to acknowledge that we are hosting this webinar from Indiana University, which is a place that is built on Indigenous homelands and resources. So we want to express our gratitude to the Miami, Delaware, Potawatomi, and Shawnee people as past, present, and future caretakers of this land. Today's webinar is going to focus on reducing energy use at wastewater treatment facilities. All the webinar attendees are muted. We ask that you enter your questions into the chat function, which you can find by hovering your mouse over the Zoom window, and there should be a chat icon that shows up. We will save most of our questions till the end, unless we have a clarifying question that pops up in the middle. And we are recording today's webinar, and I'm gonna share a link to that recording probably early next week with all the registrants. And I hope you'll enjoy the webinar so much today that you decide to share it with your colleagues as well. So I'm gonna introduce our moderator today, Janet McCabe, who is the director of IU's Environmental Resilience Institute. Janet.
Hey, thanks, Andrea. And thanks to everybody for joining us. It's great to see you all on a cold December day. I've been really looking forward to this webinar. I think I say that every time, and it's true every time, but our topics are so different and so timely that I'm really extremely sincere every time I say it. I think today's topic is so important because I think many people don't understand or realize that drinking water and wastewater treatment facilities are typically the largest energy consumers for local governments, and they can account for 30 to 40% of total energy consumed. That's just huge, you know? And if you're looking to start with, you know, pick your tired old metaphor, low hanging fruit or whatever, it's a great place to start. So for reducing greenhouse gas emissions, but as importantly or more importantly for some people, saving the city and the taxpayers money. So this is great. And we've got a couple of great presenters today. We have a national expert and a local Indiana expert, which is the way we like to do it. We have Shannon Zaret from the US Department of Energy and Michael Kuss from the City of Michigan City Sanitary District. Our webinar series is coordinated by IU's Environmental Resilience Institute. We have numerous other resources available to local governments and the general public about climate change, resilience, environmental change, and all those sorts of things. And they're behind us, there are many, many researchers at IU who are working on these issues in furtherance of solutions, data, and help for Indiana and the Midwest and beyond on the issue of climate and environmental change. I want to make sure that you know about one really important resource, and that's our resilience cohort program. It's the second one listed up there. This year, we've run 2 years of a resilience cohort. The first year, cities did greenhouse gas inventories. The second year, cities did greenhouse gas mitigation planning in coordination with supported by ERI and resources that we brought to them. This year, we're adding a third step to keep up with the needs of these communities and to help them move next into actually implementing some activities out of their resilience plans. So this is step three, but I want to emphasize that you don't have to have gone through steps one and two with us if you want to apply to be part of step three of this program. The step three cohort will focus on reducing energy use community-wide and in local government operations. And we encourage you to consider applying. We will have technical experts supporting you working as a cohort all along the way. The modules that we'll work on will focus on communities who want to be ready for solar energy, for electric vehicles, and pertinent to today's topic, reducing energy use in their wastewater and water treatment facilities. A lot of what Shannon talks about today will be the kinds of things that we'll be covering next summer and fall and into the winter. The cost to participate in this program, bargain just for you today only, no, not really, but it ranges from $400 to $800. That's only two zeros on there, depending on the size of the city. The deadline to apply is this Friday, December 11th, but I don't want you to be scared by that. because the application process is very straightforward, and there are people who can help you if you're interested in doing this. I don't want you to think, oh, it's only 2 days, I can't possibly do it. If you're interested in coming in at step one and working to develop a greenhouse gas inventory with us, we will also be accepting applications for that. So we do hope you will consider that. Andrea is going to put a link in the chat box for that program. Another resource I want to mention and draw to your attention is something called the Sustainable Development Code website. This is not developed by us. It's developed under a project led by Drake Law School in Iowa. It's an amazing resource that has just endless resources on different environmental and sustainability issues designed for local government. It's organized by category. It contains examples of good, better, and best practice suggestions for things like removing code barriers to sustainable practices, creating incentives, filling regulatory gaps, that sort of thing. We refer to it all the time, and I wanna make sure that you guys know about it in case it's helpful to you. I wanna thank the Accelerate Indiana Municipalities, the Association of Indiana Counties, Health by Design, and the Indiana Public Health Association for their continuing support of our webinar series, and of course, for all the work that they do to make Indiana a safer and healthier place. So thank you to everyone who's attending today's webinar. We hope you will enjoy it, get a lot out of it, and encourage your friends and colleagues to watch a recording of it and to consider joining our next one. We're gonna take a break in January, but our next one will be on February 10th. They are always on the second Wednesday of the month from noon to 1 Eastern time. And our topic next time will be addressing climate change in the comprehensive planning process. So if that's of interest to you, I hope you'll come and please spread the word. So I'm now gonna quickly introduce our two presenters, and then I'm gonna hand it over to Shannon to go first, and then you won't hear from me again until the end. They're just gonna transition seamlessly from Shannon to Michael. So Shannon is the Energy Technology Program Specialist at the US Department of Energy's Weatherization and Intergovernmental Programs Office. At DOE, she manages the Sustainable Wastewater Infrastructure of the Future Initiative, which is conveniently referred to as SWIFT. And they work with water resource recovery facilities to accelerate a pathway forward towards sustainable infrastructure. And I can't tell you how excited Andrea and I were when our path led us to Shannon's door and we met her and we heard about the programs that the US DOE has to help local governments across the country. Our second speaker will be Michael Kuss. He is the general manager of the Michigan City Sanitary District, where he's been since January 2012. Michael has a Bachelor of Science degree in Chemical Engineering from Tri-State University in Angola, Indiana, and previously worked for the Indiana Department of Environmental Management for 26 years as an environmental engineer. That's where I got to know Michael when I was working in the air program at IDEM, but he worked at IDEM a lot longer than I did. The Sanitary District under his tenure has just been a leader in really great programs, including clean fuel technologies, energy conservation, and pollution prevention. And he's just an all-around amazing public servant, always with the health and safety of the citizens of his community in mind. And I'm very grateful to him for everything he does for Michigan City and for the state as a whole. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Shannon to share her screen and get us started.
Okay, great. Thanks, Janet. Let me just take a second and get everything set up. Okay. All right, hopefully that looks all good. Okay. So as Janet mentioned, I work for the Department of Energy and specializing in sustainable infrastructure for wastewater facilities. And so I'll get to what that exactly means in a minute, but I'll give you an overview in terms of framing the context for what we do, talk a little bit about SWIFT, that's our acronym for the Sustainable Wastewater Infrastructure of the Future Initiative. I'll talk about the first iteration of the program, the toolkit that came out of that, as well as where we're moving towards in the future. Okay. And so as we had mentioned, our initiative works with water utilities to accelerate a pathway towards sustainable infrastructure. And so to frame the context for why reducing energy is important, we're looking at about 30 billion kilowatts per hour per year consumed in the US by municipal wastewater treatment systems. This equates to about 2 billion in annual electric costs, or 25 to 40% of a treatment plant's annual operating budget. 5 times more energy is consumed in treating wastewater than is actually needed. And this number is only going to increase as we look to demand and more stringent regulatory issues. So there is incredible opportunity to reduce energy intensity and even recover energy in a lot of these facilities. And so looking to kind of help address these issues, we had developed SWIFT back in 2016, and we worked with 70 wastewater treatment facilities all across the United States with the primary focus on reducing energy intensity. And so we started with a short-term goal to work with facilities to get down to a 5% energy intensity reduction and ultimately plan for a 30% energy reduction. So that was the primary focus of that first iteration of the program. And so on average, which was great, at the end of the program, our facilities saved about 8.1% in average energy intensity reduction. I'll kind of talk about what that equates to a little bit further on, because there are specific measures that you can put in place to yield those kinds of 5 to 10% returns within a 2-year payback period. In addition to this, we had a number of tools and resources that we developed throughout the program in order to assist the facilities in terms of data management and measure planning. And so what we did is we compiled all those tools together into a toolkit. So we're calling that the Wastewater Energy Management Toolkit. And so that's all available online. I'll show you where to locate that. But just from a very general standpoint, I'll kind of walk through what's in the toolkit. It mirrors pretty much exactly the way that that program was structured as well. So first we looked at data management. And so we really wanted to go through kind of a step-by-step guide on how to track your data and energy performance. So how to define your boundary, how to establish your baseline, how to assemble the data and apply conversions, how to track those metrics, and how to set this up as a sustainable practice. And so that's where we developed the Energy Data Management Manual. So it provides clear step-by-step guidance on how to get you from point A to point Z. Then along with that, within that manual, we compare 3 publicly available data tools. And so each of these could have, you know, several different considerations depending on the data set that you're working with. So if you have a facility that has biogas, for example, this tool might give you a little bit more data. If your facility is of a certain size, this particular tool might work out best for your data. So it just kind of gives all of the considerations so you can choose what kind of analysis that you want to have. We then moved to the measure planning stage. And so this was the area where facilities essentially identified what they wanted to implement, what types of infrastructure upgrades they wanted to implement. So we worked with our industrial assessment centers, which provide energy assessments to facilities. And they identified a pretty comprehensive checklist of low and no cost energy measures. So these are things that are not capitally intensive, to use the metaphor, kind of your low-hanging fruit. And so these are things that you can do right now, and it'll yield about a 5 to 7% energy savings with a 2-year payback period. And so within the cohort, these were the ones that a lot of our facilities implemented to get that average of 8% payback period that you were, 8% energy intensity reduction that I had talked about in the third slide. Once facilities started getting interested and they started seeing that these were yielding results, we worked with the IACs to also identify what were the next steps. What are some higher impact measures? And we broke those down into 4 main categories of different technologies you could implement, different management approaches you could take, process improvements, and even resource recovery options. And so essentially what we did in order to help them plan, because a lot of these things are very capitally intensive, so we wanted to make sure that they had the right planning in place. We developed kind of you can think of it as a scorecard. We call it the Measure Planning Workbook. It essentially allows you to think about the technology comprehensively, all the considerations that you would need to have in order to make a determination to move forward. And it allows the individual facility to weight those criteria and then score those criteria. And then it shoots back out a score. And so essentially you can see what looks okay. What's the environmental permit impact? What's the payback period? What's the level of effort needed to operate this? What's the energy savings? So depending on how you score those basic criteria, that ultimately ends up impacting your final score. So essentially it allows the facility to plan moving forward with confidence, knowing that they looked at all of these different aspects comprehensively. The next stage we moved into was the financing stage. And so what we did is we highlighted all of the public and private financing options. We brought people in who managed those financing options, as well as people who had already utilized those financing options, to kind of talk lessons learned. And so our financing matrix does highlight all of those different funding options and kind of, as you can see on the screen, goes through the various considerations. So talking about who's eligible, what types of activities are eligible, what's the application considerations, what kind of TA do they provide, what kind of technical assistance do they provide. So pretty comprehensive. We also have three search engines that help facilities find financing opportunities as well. And so our Better Buildings Financing Navigator, EPA's Water Finance Clearinghouse, and our database of state incentives for renewables and efficiency, all great resources. We also did create a guide for energy savings performance contracting. This is a particular financing mechanism that's worked well with a lot of our past partners. And so we basically wanted to create a guide to demystify the process. The very last piece of the puzzle with this is that we worked with facilities to kind of draft a 10-year energy management plan. So this is where they were planning to get to the 30%. So they had already achieved around the 5% with the low-hanging fruit. Once they selected those kind of high impact measures, we help them plan for it into the future. And so what's nice is several of the facilities have actually shared those plans with us to make public. And so this right here is an example of Miami-Dade, where they've walked through just how much energy savings, in particular the low cost measures, afforded them. And then they also kind of show you how that influenced them over time. So they have their baseline year, what happened in 2017, and then what happened in 2018. So it's a great resource to check out just exactly how the program flowed and what the impact was for these facilities. And so all of this is available on our Better Building Solutions Center. I'll make sure that the organizers, that Janet, can send that to you as well if you're interested in checking that out. But then I'll move into our phase two of the program. So SWIFT 1.0 was successful. We wanted to keep it going, but we wanted to reach a wider range of facilities. And so we separated it into two different tracks. We have SWIFT Toolkit Training and the SWIFT Energy Recovery Accelerator. And I'll get into a little bit of what those are. So the SWIFT Toolkit Training is going to be for facilities that are ready to engage with the key building blocks of energy data management. They haven't tracked their energy data before, maybe haven't explored some of that low-hanging fruit. They're really ready to get started in the energy management space. And so basically what we'll do is we'll do another kind of a round two of the SWIFT training, where we go into data management, measure planning, financing, and then plan development. The Energy Recovery Accelerator is for facilities that are ready to take the next step. So they've done all the low-hanging fruit. They're now ready to move into some more advanced technologies, or they've already done a few advanced technologies and they want to keep going. And so we have four main tracks that facilities can choose from: energy capture, so your resiliency and on-site generation, renewable energy integration, advanced energy efficiency measures, resource recovery, and then advanced data management. So those are the four options that facilities can choose from. In addition to that, we also have an energy data management component to it. So we will be giving a little bit more information about the ENPI tool, our energy performance indicator tool. So essentially what's nice about this is it lets you kind of really drill down into your data to figure out just exactly what's impacting your energy intensity. So it's really nice. It takes out a lot of the noise that's in your data so you can kind of figure out, all right, well, if I did this upgrade, is it really working? So it'll take a lot of the noise out of the data that normally is attributed to things that aren't really important into the analysis. So you can figure out, okay, if I'm taking all these steps, does it actually work? And so it takes it to another level. So it'll give you corporate, you can do corporate level rollups with it, determine CO2 avoided, forecast and backcast your data, and then it gives you that regression option. This pairs nicely with our 50,001 Ready Navigator. This basically sets up a nice framework for you to run through drafting an energy roadmap, energy management roadmap. So it looks at, okay, how are you going to get leadership buy-in for technology upgrades? How are you going to think about, you know, comprehensively planning? Is the technology, you know, viable? What do you have to think about when you're moving forward? And it shoots back out kind of a nice template that you can submit to management for any decisions that you make. What's also nice is that we're pairing with Better Plants, which is very similar to us. They work with all major energy intensive sectors. And so each facility within the program will be assigned a technical account manager, and they can spend up to 10 hours working on individualized projects or kind of like a consultant. And so if you're enjoying the program after the 3-year training period and you want to continue, we have that sustainability built in through the Better Plants program. Okay, and so we actually kicked off this past summer, so we're welcoming interested state, regional, and local agency as well as facility partners. So if you have any questions after this, feel free to reach out to me. And so we'll move over to Michael, who kind of talk about some of implementing some of these various options. So I'll come out of share screen. Okay.
Thank you very much, Shannon. I know Janet said it was going to be a seamless transition, so I hope that was seamless. First of all, I'd like to thank you for the opportunity to speak today at the Reducing Use in the Energy Water Movement for the Environmental Resource Institute from Indiana University. I'm here today to talk to you about energy savings at wastewater treatment facilities. My name is Michael Kuss. I'm the general manager at the Michigan City Sanitary District in Michigan City, Indiana, on the southern shores of Lake Michigan. And it's the largest greatest body of fresh water in the world. The title of my presentation is Energy Savings and Pollution Prevention and Wastewater Treatment Facilities. Okay, my screen's not moving. Why is that? Okay, we're gonna talk about plant operations, aeration, process control, energy reuse, energy reduction, and energy demand. What's the most important aspect of any wastewater treatment facility? Proper and adequate aeration, any activated sludge wastewater treatment facility.
Sorry to interrupt you, but I'm not seeing your screen. If you think you've shared.
Not seeing my screen?
No.
Okay, I did the share screen from the beginning. Seeing it now?
Nope.
Okie dokie, this is great. Escape.
I can share them on your behalf if you can't get it, Michael.
Zoom.
Join me or so.
In the meeting. Let me see what happens here if I do the share screen. Are you seeing it now?
No.
Nope. There might be one more button you have to select once you hit share screen. There should be a...
Oh, I didn't do that second button. I'm sorry. Okay. I'm very, very sorry. All right. Now you see it?
Yes.
Yes.
All right. Let's just go back to the beginning, but I'll go through this faster so you don't miss them. This is the title of my presentation. And then these are the things we're going to talk about: aeration, process control, energy reuse. What's the most important aspect of any activated sludge wastewater treatment facility? Proper and adequate aeration. And not only is it the most important part, but aeration is the single largest energy user at an activated sludge wastewater treatment facility. Making small changes in aeration supply can provide big savings in energy costs and huge reductions in pollution. Is this a simple, straightforward process?
I've heard, turn it down. should start seeing savings soon. After I save all this money, maybe I'll get a raise.
Unfortunately, it's not that simple, because without the proper amount of aeration, the overall objective of treating the wastewater will be compromised, polluted water will be discharged to receiving streams, and violations of the environmental rules will occur. And last but not least, you will be receiving that call from Mr. Big, the call that nobody really wants to receive. Activated sludge is a process designed to treat sewage and industrial wastewaters. It was developed around 1912, and it mimics what occurs naturally in nature, but vastly speeds up the process so that clean water can be discharged to our rivers and streams safely. This is a little diagram of how an activated sludge process works. Raw wastewater is entered into an aeration tank where air comes into the tank. Then it flows into a clarifier slash settler. The clear water, that the solids settle to the bottom and the clean water goes out. That's your treated water. At our facility, after the secondary clarifiers, we actually have sand filtration. Your return sludge goes back to the aeration tank, and this goes around in a circle, and then you have a little sludge waste stream down here. The biomass mixture in the aeration tank is commonly known as mixed liquor. Solids typically range between 2,500 and 6,000 milligrams per liter, and the dissolved oxygen at the end of the aeration tank needs to be between 1 and 2 milligrams per liter to achieve adequate treatment. This is a couple pictures of some blowers that are used. The one on the left is positive displacement blowers, and the one on the right is some pictures of some newer turbine blowers. How much air is needed in the wastewater facility? Blowers are used to supply the air, and more specifically oxygen, to the biomass, but they're also, the air is also needed to keep the mixture in suspension. Without enough air in the tank, even if your DO is good at the end of your tank, you still have to have enough air to keep the biomass in suspension. Using the 10 state standards, you need 1.1 pounds of oxygen for every pound of BOD and 4.6 pounds of oxygen for every pound of ammonia to treat every pound of ammonia. You might notice when Shannon was giving her presentation that they based everything on ammonia treatment, which is a good thing because why? It requires more oxygen. Oxygen needed at our design capacity, at our treatment facility, is 31,225 pounds per day of oxygen we need. That's a lot of oxygen. And the amount of air needed is nearly 2 million cubic feet per day of air that we need at our design criteria at our facility here in Michigan City. There's two types of diffusers typically. One is coarse aeration, which produces a large bubble, and fine aeration, which produces a smaller bubble. The oxygen transfer efficiency on the coarse aeration is about 4%, and you get 12% on the fine bubble. So if you look at how much air you need for a coarse air compared to fine air, you note that the coarse air bubble uses about 300% more oxygen, or more air than the fine aeration diffuser does. So if you have coarse air diffusers, this is the first thing you could do, low hanging fruit, change them out to fine air. You will start seeing substantial savings. Also though, you have to treat for the fluctuations that you get during the day. At our facility, we get DO sags nearly every single day that usually start between 1 and 2 in the afternoon and usually last between 6 to 8 PM. The dissolved oxygen in aeration tanks will start to drop and we will need more air. Then therefore you want to choose a blower that can supply low enough air when you don't need to have more supply, but also a large enough amount of air that can handle the fluctuations. Old school on this was to have a constant airflow based on the worst case design scenario. New technologies, DO meters are installed in aeration tanks to control and regulate the airflow. How does that work? Here's our back to our design of our plant. Here's your DO meter that you have in your aeration tank, and that's connected by wires to your controls, to your blowers, and they'll either ramp up or ramp down. If you notice here, this meter is reading 5.34 milligrams per liter. If you need 1 to 2 milligrams per liter at the end of the tank, then you should have sufficient air in this little drone. But as the DO in the tanks go down, the airflow increases, and as the DO in the aeration tanks rise, the airflow can decrease. How is that done? It's done through process control. Here's an example of our blower control panel on the outside, and these are our programmable logic controllers on the inside with much of the wiring. We'll take a look at this little screen here. This is a close-up of this screen. These are our two turbine blowers, number 4 and number 5. Those were the positive displacement blowers that we replaced about 2.5 to 3 years ago now, so we kept the same numbers. If you notice here, number 4 blower is running, and it's running at 60% speed. And 60% speed is our minimum speed that we need to keep our aeration tanks mixed. And as you can see, we have 6 aeration tanks, 1 through 6, and tanks 7 and 8 we don't have, but our DO is well above 2 milligrams per liter in all 6 of these tanks. But if it drops, any tank drops below 6, below 2 milligrams per liter, this blower will ramp up speed. If this blower is not enough to keep up with the process, then a second blower will turn on until the air is satisfied. This is an overhead picture of our blower room. Is some of our old blowers still in existence. We need those for our firm capacity. And these are our two new blowers, our turbine blowers that we have installed nearly 3 years ago now. This is an example of our process control SCADA system that we have on our computer. The first screen is an overall, and you can click on these boxes here to, if you want to go to various parts of the plant. We normally show the headworks, the blower building, secondary effluent, and filter control building. Process control is very important, great way to save energy. Where is the blower air also used? It's also used in our final, in our aerated slash bubbler channel, and also in our post-aeration process. This is a close-up screen of the blower. You can see here's the number 4 blower is operating. And if you note, this air goes up here to the west aeration tanks, which we have 3, and the east aeration tanks, which are 4, 5, and 6. And then if you notice, there's a valve here that also supplies air to post-aeration. We don't yet have a flow meter on that, but we'll get to that in a second. And then also some of the air from the turbine blower also goes to what we call our aerated channel or our bubbler channel. What we did on those two valves was we installed these actuators, automatic control actuators. The valve on the left is the valve that we installed on the post-aeration pipe, and the valve on the right is the valve that we installed on the aerated channel slash bubbler channel. This is a picture of our one of our aeration tanks, and then from the aeration tank, it flows to our secondary clarifier. But before it goes to the clarifier, we have this long aerated channel that helps to distribute the mixed liquor into the clarifier. And we need to keep that aerated so it doesn't settle out. We don't put a lot of air in there, just enough air to keep it mixed. And what we try to keep that at is 650, between 645 and 655 cubic feet per minute. And this is the meter that, the meter on the left here, that's at, took this picture a couple days ago, 646, so it's right on the money. And that's something that we're controlling now. So now when we need more air in the aeration tanks, when we will be able to supply the air to the west aeration tank or to the east aeration tank when they need more air. We're looking at putting valving on all of our aeration tanks, but unfortunately for us, the way our system is designed, we need to have 24 of these valves. And I think we're looking at almost $50,000 to $100,000 for those valves. So we might implement that little by little. This is our post aeration tank. Our limit is 7 milligrams per liter. We have this DO meter here in this picture. You can see it's 9.02. We have this set to achieve at least 8.5 milligrams per liter. We don't want to go anywhere near our minimum 7. So we want to keep it above that. And this picture on the left shows what the amount of aeration in our post aeration tank looked like before we put the controls on. And this picture on the right, you can see, which has much less air, is the picture that was taken that matches up to that 9.02 milligrams per liter. So as you can see, we were wasting a lot of air for the post aeration, and really weren't getting much benefit out of it at all. And now when our aeration tanks need more air because of a DO sag, the air will be supplied to the aeration tanks, where before we were already over aerating our post aeration, we were even sending more air over there. So that's an example of energy savings. Now I'd like to move into energy reuse, use reduction, and energy demand savings. We'll talk about digester gas, filter backwashing, and capacitors. Here's our digester, primary digester 1. We have another primary digester 2, which you really can't see. This is our secondary digester here, and then this is our holding tank. If you notice, this is a flare for flaring off our gas. You do not see a flame. Why do you not see a flame? Because we use 100% of our digester gas to reheat our digesters. They have to be maintained between above 95 degrees. We maintain ours around 98 to 100 degrees Fahrenheit. And the orange pipe here is the digester gas coming in. You can see the valve is in the open position. And the yellow pipe is actually the natural gas line that comes in case we were to lose the digester gas. And there's a regulator that automatically happens with. When I started working at the Sanitary District of Michigan City in 2012, we were never using this system. They hadn't used it for 20 years. They told me it wouldn't work. I said, it'll work, let's try it. And we tried it. I worked out a few kinks, didn't really take very long. And ever since then, we've been operating on the digester gas to heat our digesters. That's a huge energy savings. These are our sand filters, a picture of our sand filters. We have 10 of these cells. This is our clear water coming in from our sand secondary effluent. It goes into this trough and distributed through the sand filter. This picture on the left is the filter at low. Once this filter starts to clog, the water will build up. And this picture on the right is after a little bit height, nearing ready to get a backwash cycle. Picture on the left is what happens when it backwashes. Once the filter can't really take much more flow through it and builds up too much head pressure, automatic floats send it into an automatic backwash mode. And the screen on the right shows you the backwashes about two a day or one and a half a day. We were backwashing our filters at least three times a day, sometimes four or five times a day when we were doing them in manual mode. This is another thing that plant operators told me couldn't be done. And I actually didn't get around to fixing this one until about April of this year. They told me it wouldn't work. The whole building will shut down. I said, we're going to try it. We put it in auto control. And believe me, it works fantastic. And this is really saving us a lot of money. So auto control on your sand filters, reduce your backwashing, you're reducing the pumping, and you're saving a lot of energy. That backwash water goes back to the head of the plant and is retreated. So you're recycling that water around more than you really need to. Capacitors in 2019, I believe it was, or maybe late of 18, we installed these capacitors. Cost us $30,000 to install these capacitors. We're saving $17,000 a year. So that's a no-brainer. We've already saved enough energy costs on our energy demand to pay for the installation of these. And this is really saving us a lot of money. If you don't have a 95% rating here, you pay a penalty. And we have been at 99. We were paying the penalty quite often, and now we're at 99 or 100% every single week. How much energy have we saved, and what are the pollution benefits? These are the utility rates that we're paying. Our energy demand was calculated out at $28,000 a year savings after we installed some of these energy savings projects. And we have the usage savings of $46,000. So our annual calculated energy savings was about $75,000 a year. Our actual savings in the first year was $56,000. Our second year was $70,000. Our third year was $88,000. Most recently, after some of the additional controls that we've installed, October and November were right around $9,000, and December was $7,700. If you take the average of that and multiply it by 12, you're looking at about $100,000 a year in savings. So not only are you reducing energy, but you're saving money. The annual reduction is about 857 megawatt hours. And according to the U.S. Energy Information Administration, the EIA, you reduce pollution for every megawatt hour. You reduce sulfur dioxide by 3.3 pounds, 2.1 pounds of nitrogen oxide, and 1,883 pounds of carbon dioxide for every megawatt hour of energy that you save. So for our facility, we're reducing sulfur dioxide by 2,830 pounds a year, nitrogen oxide by 1,800 pounds a year, and carbon dioxide by 1,600 pounds per year. And last but not least, I just want to say that you have to build partnerships if you want to be environmentally sustainable. And if you want to prevent pollution, this is one of the most key aspects to saving energy and environmental sustainability, and partnerships are the key to those two areas. And I just want to mention two of our partners that we work with is the Indiana Partners for Pollution Prevention. This is run through IDEM, and also the Northwest Indiana Partners for Clean Air. I would strongly encourage anyone in the audience to really look at joining either one of these programs. There's a lot of benefits and a lot of good comes from both of these programs. And of course, the Indiana University Environmental Resilience Program is also another great resource and another great partnership. So like I said, Michael Kuss, Michigan City, Indiana, beautiful Michigan City on the southern shores of Lake Michigan. I wanna say again that the information presented in this presentation, it can be seen that there are many ways to reduce energy and save money and reduce pollution. So I guess we're open for any questions. Thank you for your time and I appreciate the opportunity to speak.
Well, Michael and Shannon, those were fantastic presentations. I feel like I want to come work in a wastewater treatment plant now, honestly. I have never had anybody make it seem so fun and exciting to work in a wastewater treatment plant, Michael. You need to go on the road with that presentation.
We've got some openings on the midnight shift, Janet, if you want to come down, and we're looking for some operators. So.
Okay, awesome. All right, so please feel free to put your questions in the chat. We've already had one that came in for Shannon about the cost to participate in the DOE programs, and she's responded that there is no cost, which is the answer she gave Andrea and me when we asked. So it's good that it's the same answer. Bennett Brabson put a question in the chat. Michael, could you give us an average number of kilowatt hours per household for wastewater treatment? Also, it would be useful to know how much energy is needed to provide clean water to a typical household.
I do not have those. I do not have that information at hand, but the numbers that I supplied in my presentation, we have about 10,000 customers. Now that includes, commercial and residential, probably about 8,000 residential. But if you wanted to take those numbers and divide by 8,000, that would probably give you a pretty good handle on that. But I think that's a very good question. Shannon may actually have some information on that, but if not, we can look at trying to calculate that.
Yeah, I don't have it from a granular level. We have more of the national data, but we can definitely get something like that for you.
Okay. Well, while other people are thinking of their questions, I have another one for you, Michael, which is how challenging was it for you to convince your management to make these investments? I can sense that part of it was the power of personality and just, I'm gonna try this. I really don't care if you think it's not gonna work, I'm gonna try it. But somebody had to approve the expenses. So how did you go about making the case for these being good investments to make?
Well, first of all, it's really not that hard of a sell when you put together the information. What we did was we didn't do the detailed audit that Shannon talked about, but we did do an energy audit and we had some different options put forth in front of us. And we looked at those options and actually it was a lot broader perspective that they wanted us to do for a lot larger cost. And I actually did a lot of analyzation of all that myself and found out where can we get the most bang for our buck. And that was definitely with the aeration. The other stuff they wanted us to do, some of it was like overpriced. We decided we just try to do some of this on our own. For instance, this valving part, they wanted $500,000 to install these valves, not just the two I showed you, but all the valves. And we know we can do that on our own for a lot less. When I say they, talking about our energy consultant engineering firms. And but to do this for us here in Michigan City, we have a wonderful board and our former mayor was a large proponent of the environment and our current mayor is too, Mayor Perry, giving us the opportunity to continue with the things that we started. I'd like to thank him for that. And so it's really not that hard of a sell. And when you show the amount of money you're saving, you know, it's a no-brainer when you just show that. Works pretty simple. So hope that answers the question.
Yep, great. So here's a question from Nolan Hendon. Shannon mentioned five times more energy is used than necessary for wastewater treatment. Other than over aeration, where do you see that overuse of energy in the system? That's a great question.
I would say that is primarily the biggest energy consumer. I'd say anything in your secondary treatment is definitely going to go up. Up from that, it really depends on the facility level, some of the things that they implement. And you could get kind of a backlog of thinking where anecdotally we've heard of some people who've implemented some of the next generation technologies, especially in the realm of like disinfection, thinking that, okay, we're gonna, you know, the primary objective is always to comply with the regulatory requirements and produce the, you know, the water to the certain quality that is required in the state. And the challenge is that, you know, further down the line, sometimes certain technologies that help you comply with the regulatory requirements can also boost your energy intensity. And so that's another thing that we've seen that's been an interesting dynamic. So as you're advancing, certain technologies might impact that. And so that's kind of where the long-term and the comprehensive planning came into play for us. And so looking at some of those things that, yes, it may serve some other type of environmental benefit somewhere else, but at the same time, how is this going to look for my energy budget down the line? And so that's been an interesting piece of the puzzle as well.
So as a non-expert in this, I had always thought that that pumps were a big energy user in the system, and that upgrading pumps could be a big energy savings. But I haven't heard either of you mention that as a particular area of focus.
Well, they are a focus. It's just that there's different types of wastewater treatment facilities too. What I talked about was the activated sludge process, probably overall the most popular treatment facility that you'll see works great, but there are other facilities like a trickling filter, for instance. Their major energy use is not going to be aeration because they don't really do much aeration at all. It's going to be pumps. And pumps certainly do use a lot of energy. And what you want to do there is you want to try to go to variable speed, variable control pumps, those types of things. That'll help save some energy.
Great. All right. A couple more questions here. For Shannon, do you know how the energy data the program receives is smoothed out?
I am certainly not the data expert on our team, but what I can say is that the system essentially allows you to input a number of different variables. So as far as whether, you know, whatever it is, you know, your energy consuming that's going in, as well as any other variables that could impact that energy use. And essentially it allows you to kind of turn off the variables that could confound that data. And so that way you can see, okay, if you've implemented a new system, you can essentially shut off, like, let's say, for example, you did install, you know, some UV, for example, and that might take up an additional amount of energy, but then you've done all of these kind of low hanging fruit system process upgrades. You can kind of smooth it out and take out that particular energy variable or that particular line of consumption so you can see the impact of your other activities. From a very high level, that's kind of how we do it. As far as getting into the nitty gritty of regression analysis, I can definitely connect you with our team that specializes in that.
Okay, great. And we'll make sure that people know how to get a hold of people. Here's one from Michael. Could you describe what some of the initial issues were with the biogas furnace that you fixed?
Well, I think that the biggest issue overall was you'll find in life in general, people want to always try to take the easy way out. Okay, so it's a lot easier to just take that nice, clean, natural gas that you're getting from, in our case, NIPSCO, and just use that to turn your boiler. It's not really a boiler, but it heats up the water. I guess it's kind of a boiler, and use that. And then just flare off the gas from the digester. That's easy. And I think that's probably was the number one thing, is just trying to change some mindsets. And, you know, that gas will work. Sometimes it's, you know, people say it's dirty or whatever. Yeah, there's some, it's not as clean as the natural gas you get, but it works fine. The only problem we had at all was some of those regulators. We just needed to actually adjust the regulators a little bit, but really there was really no issues with it whatsoever. It's just a matter of, you got to keep an eye on it, and it's just harder to do. So I know that's hard for you to understand, but a lot of people just want to take the easy way out.
And do you have a sense of how much money that saves the city to use your own gas?
Oh, I would say at least $10,000 a year.
There you go. Okay. This could be for either of you or both of you. What about solar energy? Do you see that fitting into wastewater treatment?
So it is on the list of the recommendations that we have. It typically is not the first approach that a lot of facilities tend to implement. We tend to start with that low-hanging fruit first and then move into the process and efficiency measures. So it's definitely something that is of interest to certain facilities, but it's certainly a lot of times after a lot of those process efficiency measures have been implemented. But it can play a significant role.
Yeah, I could add to that too, that's exactly where we are here in Michigan City. That's the next thing that we're looking at. We've done a lot of different evaluations of where we could put a solar array of panels, and that seems to be exactly what Shannon said, is right on the money. I will tell you that, as you know, Janet, I'm sure you know, in Indiana, at least, you used to be able to get a pretty good payback on your energy that you produced from your solar panels. I think that got changed 2, 3, 4 years ago. LaPorte, Indiana, which is just down the street from Michigan City, they have a large solar array. In fact, I think they're not 100% off the grid, but they're probably about 90% off the energy grid right now using solar power. So it's definitely an advantage, but you got to have the room for it. That's one of the things too. You know, we're talking about putting some on some of our roofs, but by the time you do that, the cost for it and the amount of savings is pretty minimal. So.
Well, just a reminder, if people are interested in learning how to help your city become ready for solar energy, you might want to apply for our cohort to work with us on that next year. So here's a question from James Sullivan for Michael. Michael, what was your average electrical cost prior to implementing efficiencies? Or generally, what was your percentage of monthly electricity savings?
Okay, I could look at my computer and give you the exact numbers if you wanted me to, but I will just tell you that our energy bill is usually around $40,000 to $45,000 a month. So you can see the savings that we're having. We're down around maybe $32,000 to $38,000 a month, depending on high or low. So you don't realize that you get your energy bill at home and you're thinking, wow, I got a $500 bill, but you get to open up the bill here and it's $38,000, and you're saying to yourself, okay, hope we got the money to pay that. But yeah, that's it. So it's pretty substantial. It really is.
It sounds like sort of 25% are on that order.
Yeah.
That's pretty good.
Well, and let me just add to that. Don't forget the rates are going up. You know, our rates went way up this year. So, you know, that's one of the reasons we're saving more money, because the rates went up so much. So if we hadn't instituted these energy savings, when I was saying $40,000 to $45,000 bill, we'd probably be looking at $44,000 to $50,000 bill. So that's the other thing you got to think about. I'm sure that Shannon tells people that all the time at Department of Energy. The rates are just going to keep going up. So,
yeah. Well, that's we don't have any more questions in the chat. Does anybody just want to unmute themselves and ask a question before we wrap up? Oh, here's one. Michael, this is for you. How did the energy savings impact the budget on a city level? Did the residents see any rate changes on their water bills as a result of this? Good question.
Yeah, it is a really good question. One of the hardest things to do in a water plant or a wastewater plant is to raise the rates. And we went through a rate study in 2012 and actually did have to raise our rates. I'm sure if you guys want to do some research, there was a lot of issues here in Michigan City prior to me coming here, and we did a lot of work. But anyways, what we have done, we have not been able to give any payback to the residents because we don't have a mechanism for that. But what we have done is hold the line on any rate increases. We have not had a rate increase now for 8 years since 2012, and our budget is doing very well. We're doing good, and certainly this energy savings certainly helps with that.
Yeah, the mayor probably likes it when he sees you coming through the door.
Yeah, let's hope so.
All right. Any more questions from anybody?
I have a question, if I could, for Shannon. Is there any grants? I know I was joking with you about the grants, but is there any grants available from the Department of Energy for wastewater treatment facilities?
So through this program, the way that we kind of work, and you can think of it as kind of defraying the cost of hiring a consultant, it's like the first step in the process. And so what we do from there, because our particular office just provides technical assistance, the other program offices tend to provide financing for upgrades. So what we tend to do in this program is try to connect facilities with funding opportunities. So if there's something out there and available now, we'll try to make sure that we have some type of workshop where we're bringing people in that can talk about the different funding opportunities that are currently available. So that's that's how we tend to make sure that people get access to that.
I will just say that that Andrea and I were over the moon excited to hear about the opportunities for local governments to be part of the Shannon's programs at no cost to them. And we personally are very eager to stay up on the opportunity there. And if we can help facilitate getting questions answered, I would love to see a huge number of Indiana communities go to the Department of Energy and say, Indiana is here and we want to do all these things and please help us. So if we can be help facilitate that for you or be a conduit to get answers to questions, please reach out to Andrea or me on this particularly. And just in larger terms, please do reach out to us if you have any questions about the resources that we have at the Environmental Resilience Institute, or if you have a question about these kinds of issues. One of the cool things that we get to do is collect great stories and experiences from around the state and around the Midwest of great things that communities have done to save energy, save money, protect the environment, help address climate change, and then make those available to everybody so that you guys don't have to reinvent a single wheel that somebody else in a comparable city has already invented, which is why I was so thrilled to have Michael here today. I mean, this there are people that do what he does all over the state, and if they can do these things, then you guys sure can too. So Andrea has just posted, before you go, if you wouldn't mind, quickly responding to our poll so that we can keep providing topics that you're interested in and speakers that are effective. We were thrilled to have you all here today. Thank you once again to our speakers from Michigan City and the Department of Energy. Our next webinar will be in February on climate change and comprehensive planning. Andrea, as people are filling out their polls, do you want to have anything else you want to say so that they'll actually fill it out and not just sign off?
Well, I guess I can really encourage any local government who's interested in signing up for Shannon's program. We're hopefully going to do an Indiana-specific program through this resilience cohort. So I would certainly encourage you to sign up or at least contact me if you'd like more information. And I posted both Janet's email and my email in the chat, so you can reach out to us directly.
All right.
And of course, you can contact Shannon or Michael too. I'm sure they'd be happy to share their expertise as well.
Yep, and you will, in a couple of days, you'll get an email from Andrea with a link to the recording and a link to presentations and resources. And we try to provide as much useful information as we can. So thanks once again. And if you haven't voted, please do before you sign off. And have a wonderful holiday season. And please stay safe and well, everybody. Take good care of yourselves.
Thank you.